Minecraft 1.20.3 brings us plenty of technical news in addition to all the fun gameplay changes I've already showcased in my main update video. My name is Sly Slime, and in this one I'm going to show you all the changes for commands, scoreboards, structures, and much more. First of all, the data pack version is now 26, and the resource pack version is now 22. Let's start with commands and the tick command. Those of you familiar with Carpet Mod might recognize this. The tick command is an administrative tool to control the flow of time in a Minecraft world. It has a number of different modes, so let's go through them one at a time. First of all, tick query gives you information about the current tick rate and performance. The result value is the current tick rate in integer form. The next subcommand is tick rate, followed by a rate in ticks per second. This sets the update speed of the server. The value must be between 1 and 10,000 ticks per second, with 1 leading to very slow updates. Setting the rate too high means the server will be seen as unresponsive and might crash, so it's a good idea to measure the tick rate with tick query or the performance graphs to make sure you pick a reasonable number. When the tick rate is lower than the default 20, player movement and controls are also scaled down, but for higher values, player movement stays the same to ensure you still have control of the game. Let's move on to tick sprint. This is followed by a time argument and causes the game to run as fast as possible for the specified number of ticks worth of in-game time. Essentially, this lets you fast forward the game simulation to see the result of a mechanism or so, which is useful for measuring gameplay elements that depend on speed, like farm throughput. You can also abort a running sprint by running tick sprint stop. The last functionality of the tick command is the ability to freeze the world entirely, which is started by using tick freeze. This causes all elements of the game world to stop simulating with the exception of players and any entity ridden by a player, which means you can move around and study the state of the world. While in the state, you can use the next tick subcommand, tick step. This takes a time value and runs that amount of ticks, which means you can step the game simulation one or a few ticks at a time to debug a contraption or see in details what's going on. The default value for tick step is 1 tick, so just running tick step will run the simulation of 1 game tick. Finally, you can do tick unfreeze to return the world to regular simulation again. One thing to note is that the tick command is considered an admin level command, or numerically speaking, level 4, so it is by default not available for use in data packs. To be able to use it in a function, you'll need to set the function permission level server.properties value to 4 and run the pack on a dedicated server. The execute if function and return run command forms have returned. These commands were previously introduced in snapshot 23W31A, but then backed out due to bugs before the release of 1.20.2. Now they're back, so let's talk about what they do. Let's start with execute if function. This is a new conditional for calling functions and proceeding if the result is a success. The syntax is execute if or unless function, followed by the ID of a function or function tag, then the continuation of the execute command. The function or function tag is run and the execute command continues if or unless at least one of the functions succeeded. A function success is defined as the function using the return command to return a value and that value being non-zero. If you run it with a tag, all the functions act as one, and so any return inside any of the called functions will abort the rest. If none of the functions return, execute if will now fail, and execute unless will pass. The return command has also been extended with a new form, return run. This form of return executes a specified command and uses the result value of that command as a return value for the function. If the command failed, the return run command will also cause the function that contained it to fail, which causes the success and result values to both become zero. If the command forks into multiple execution paths, like when using return run execute as, the first execution will give the result. Return run can now also store values. So running a command like execute store something, run return run some command will both store the result value of some command and return that result out from the function. There's a new form of the return command too, return fail, that fails the current function, returning a failure with both success and result values set to zero. Together with this, the game has now become better at handling incomplete commands, which will now prevent functions from loading, and incomplete execute commands will not run. This is also accompanied by a change to the function command and how functions return results. Previously, a function command executed from the chat input would return the number of commands executed, while a function command executed from inside another function would return something undefined. Now, a function that doesn't use the return command has no result at all. A function also does not have a result if an error occurs while instantiating the function call. That is to say, the function didn't exist, you tried to call an empty function tag, or you called a macro which contained syntax errors while instantiating. The function command has also changed in this version. If you use it together with a function tag to run multiple functions, those now act as one combined function with regards to returns. So if the first function returns, the second one does not run. More in general, any function that returns will also return out through a return run in its calling function. You can think about it as if the first return will cause all other executions to stop, which is what you'd expect from other languages. There are also some changes to limits regarding commands in the form of game rules. These limits now also apply when run from the chat inputs, so commands in a function work the same way as commands run from chat. The max command chain length limit has been changed to count operations, where one operation is the execution of a single command for a single context, the execution of a stage in an execute command, or calling a function. There's also a new game rule called max command fork count, which limits the number of forks. A fork here is defined as a unique context for running commands, so you could view it as the total amount of combinations all execute commands lead to. The default value for this is 65,536. There are also some more gameplay-centric game rules, like projectiles can break blocks, which controls whether chorus flowers and decorated pots can be broken by impact projectiles like arrows, and whether pointed dripstone can be broken by tridents. There are two other new game rules which are closely related. Player Nether Portal Default Delay and Player Nether Portal Creative Delay. They control the time it takes in a number of ticks to pass through another portal for players in creative mode for the creative rule, and for players in survival or adventure mode for the default rule. Scoreboard entries now have display names and number formats. Display names mean you can set exactly how a scoreboard entry's name should appear. This is done using a new subcommand, scoreboard players display name. For instance, this lets you display a mob with a custom name in a scoreboard instead of its UUID. The display name of a score holder is a text component, but its content is not resolved, so sources like score, selector, and NBT do not work. The name disappears if the score for that entity is reset or the objective is removed. If the name is not present, then the scoreholder name is used instead, which is the entity UUID or player name just like before. Either way, team decorations are applied to the name as usual. There's also a new function called DisplayAutoUpdate. This is set per objective with a new property DisplayAutoUpdate for scoreboard objectives modify. When it is on, the name of a scoreholder will update from the in-game name of that entity anytime its score changes. If the score at that point does not refer to a loaded entity, the current display name is kept. The other big change is number formatting. Score displays in numeric form now have options for how they are formatted. This is managed with a default formatting set per objective, and there is also an individual format per score holder in that objective. Use scoreboard objectives modify with the number format property to set the default format for an objective, and scoreboard players display number format for setting the format for a specified score holder. The format is one of blank, fixed, and styled. Blank means the score holder shows as blank. No number shows up at all. Fixed is always followed by a text component and means that text component is shown instead of the score, so regardless of what the actual number is, that text component shows up instead. And styled is followed by a text style. You can think about this text style much like a text component, but without the actual content, so you can use fields like color, bold, and so on. That style is then used to display the value of the score. The title of a scoreboard is now always shown in the sidebar, even if that objective has no score. Hey, if you're still with me after all that, let me just say thank you. You've certainly made it into my list of favorite people. Please consider hitting the like button or dropping a sub to the channel. These videos take a huge amount of time and effort to make, so I'd really appreciate it. Let's move on to structures and begin with some noteworthy changes to the jigsaw structure type, where the maximum depth of generation specified by the size value has been raised from 7 to 20. Jigsaw structures now have an optional field called the pool aliases, which is a list of aliases. An alias allows the structure to rewire jigsaw connections when generating the structure by redirecting references. There are three types of such aliases. The first one is direct and represents a one-to-one mapping from an alias name to a new pool. This has alias and target fields to specify those. The second one is called random, that picks a target at random from a list in the targets field. And finally, there's also random group. This is a field called groups, in which each entry in itself is a pool alias. One such group is selected for the entire structure, and that alias is then used for all pieces. This means you can make multiple connected mappings, like replace house with igloo and also iron golem spawn with snow golem spawn. Jigsaw blocks have two new options in this version: selection priority and placement priority. These values control the order in which elements are evaluated while a structure is generating. Selection priority controls which order jigsaws are evaluated when the pieces for a structure are picked. Higher values are picked first, and all jigsaws with the same priority are picked in random order. In a hypothetical village example, this could mean jigsaws intended to generate houses are picked before jigsaws intended to generate fence decorations. The placement priority controls the order in which the piece connected to that jigsaw is processed for connections. Here too, higher values are picked first, with the default insertion order taking over for jigsaws with the same priority. This lets you make some parts of jigsaw structures in a depth-first manner, and gives more control over how internal connections are used. And the beehive, bee nest, and bell blocks now rotate correctly when loaded using structure blocks. There are also new entity type tags in this version. First, the convenient collection tags for zombies and undead, but also a new tag controlling behavior: can breathe underwater. There's also a new damage type tag: can break armor stands, for damage that can knock down armor stands if applied multiple times in a row. Let's talk about data changes. Grass has been renamed to short grass. This goes both for the displayed name of the block and item, and the IDs used in commands and other datapack features. Decorated pot block entities now contain an item field, which contains item stack data in the standard format. Alternatively, you can also use the loot table tag, like chests and many other containers. Setting the loot table of a decorated pot means that loot table is evaluated when the pot is smashed, causing one item stack rolled from the table to drop along with the shards of the pot. Note that the loot table is exclusive with having loot inside the pot, so setting a loot table erases any items inside, and placing an item into the pot removes the loot table. The cracked block state of decorated pots has been changed so pots with that state set will always shatter when broken. The wither skull field for the type of skull, blue or regular, is now properly saved and read from NBT. And the name of non-living entities now behave the same as living entities when it comes to having custom name and custom name visible fields. The trident field in trident projectiles is now called item, and a similar item field has been added to all kinds of arrows. This is an item stack format field, and it represents the item that conceptually was used when the projectile was fired, and as such also the item that will be picked up. The fuse field of TNT block entities is now all lowercase, and there's a new optional field called block state. When specified, this field represents the block model that is rendered. And clocks and compasses now show the correct time and direction when used in display entities. There are 5 new particle types in this version. 3 of them are related to the breeze and the trial spawners: gust, gust dust, and trial spawner detection. Then we have dust plume. This is the particle used when adding items to decorated pots. And white smoke. This is the puff of smoke used when the crafter crafts an item. In resource pack news, the Unifont library version used for the Unicode font in the game is now version 15.1.04. Resource pack downloading has changed. It now shows up as a toast showing the download progress instead of showing a full screen overlay. This download now also starts immediately when chunk loading starts. Downloaded packs are now stored in the Downloads folder instead of in Server Resource Packs. The game now keeps only the last 20 Server Resource Packs downloaded, and that folder now also contains a log file for what downloads have been done. On the server side, resource packs have been given a UUID, and there's a new Resource Pack ID field in the server.properties file. If that field is missing or empty, the UUID will be calculated based on the download URL. If there's no given hash for the resource pack, that will now cause the client to download the pack every time. Previously, the pack would just remain how it was. Packs with the same size but a different hash are now also properly re-downloaded. For modded servers, there are also some new possibilities. The game client can now accept more than one resource pack at a time, and there's a new packet for unapplying packs that were previously added by the server. Resource packs no longer get cleared when re-entering the configuration phase, which was a big problem for some minigame servers and other big servers with many different resource packs. And that's it for the technical changes in Minecraft 1.20.3. Thank you for watching, my name is SliceLime, and I'll see you next time.